Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. In the previous video, we talked about this little fellow, our finger, and we talked about the mouse. But sometimes you want more than just single finger input. You want to have one of those gestures that you can see here on the screen. We have flick, that's the just taking something, moving it around. We have swipe, where you'd like two fingers go from one screen to the next screen, or well, one finger too, I guess. You have pinch, that's this zooming thing with two fingers. We have tab and hold, that's often used for configuration where you hold your finger on something for just a second or two and then some configuration kicks in. And if one of those is not exactly what you need, you might want to implement a user interface where you have like kind of a dial on the screen or something like that. Here's the good news, you can do your own multi-touch input in QML. We'll start out talking about flick. After that, we'll talk about pinch. Hey, did I miss one? Swipe? Yes, I did. We're not going to talk about swipe in this video. There is a link in the message below my video here where you can go and look up how do you do swipe in QML. It requires knowledge about list view that we'll see much later in this session. So let's look at how do I do flick in QML. There is an element called a flickable, and I basically create a flickable, I give it a width and a height, as any other QML element, and then I give it a content width and a content height. The way that works is that you're looking through this little hole onto your much larger content. So the much larger content is where whatever you flick around is located. And then the little hole, that is your actual width and height of the element that you look at. So in this example here, my flickable has a child, that is my image. My image, as always, is loading in a source. But the image also, we could use just the default width and height of the image if we wanted to. But in this example, we specify the width and the height. And the width and the height that we specify is that of the content width and the content height of our flickable. Let's try and see this example in action. So now I'm running the application here, and you can see my fingers. This isn't the one where I'm zooming, I'm just flicking things around. So you can see I flick the element around here, and if I make it full screen, you can see I still cannot zoom, but I can flick it around as you can see. That's one thing to notice about the flickable element, namely that what you look at on the screen, by now you will think, hey, image is a child element of flick. But it isn't. It's a child element of the content area. And if we just go to the flickable here, to the documentation for that, we'll see that we have this content item. So the large element that we talked about, that of which we are looking through a small keyhole, that large element is our content item. And that is the item that is the parent of the flickable. It's important if you dynamically, as you can see in this code here, via JavaScript, add new elements in there, because then they need to be parented with the content item, not the flickable. And of course, it's important, had I wanted to refer to the content width here using parent, had I written parent.contentWidth and parent.contentHeight, I would actually go to content width and content height property, which likely doesn't exist, on the content item, not on the flickable. That was flicking. Next, that's what I already tried, cannot help my fingers, is pinching. That's this that you zoom with two fingers. The way that it works is that you often have a pinch area inside your flickable. And you can see in this code here, I got my flickable, content width 2000, content height 2000. And then I got my pinch area, and my pinch area is set up with a bunch of properties to specify exactly what I'm pinching. So first of all, my pinch area is an element. Remember what we need to do with elements? We need to anchor them. Otherwise, the size, well, we learned that yesterday. Well, we learned that whatever you saw that video, they will by default be 0 times 0. And that's, it's of course not a very useful size to work with. So anchors.fill parent. Then I need to specify who is it that I'm actually pinching, and so I specify pinch area to target being the image here. The minimum and maximum scale here, that's so that I cannot pinch outside a given size here. And drag axis is how do I want to resize it? Can I resize it? Can I even rotate it? Which is another feature of the pinch area. My image down here, same as before, width and height is set to the size of the flickable element. I actually have two different versions of this. The first version, that's what we have here. And that's exactly the code that we already saw, so we can run that right away. It doesn't look like much when you start out, but that's because that we are zoomed so far out. So let's see here, and I'll zoom. Oh, come on, where are you? There we are. It is a really, really big rocket, so there was lots and lots of white space up there. But you can see that now I'm, here is my rocket, and I can pinch zoom it like this. One problem that I had with this example here, and we'll solve that with the next example, is that I do not specify which area I'm zooming around. So if I want more control, then I need the more fast version here. And let's look at what that code does. Here is the advanced version of the pinch area. This time I need two properties of my own. We saw that previously, that I can create my own properties. So this is really just for my it's like local variables had this been an imperative programming. On pinch start, that's a signal handler for whenever I start my pinching operation. And there I just remember the current content size into these two properties that we have there. Whenever I am pinching around, I get an on pinch update. So that's the signal handler for whenever I've changed my pinch size. And there I do flick.resizeContent. Flick, that's the flickable element that we have up here. Resize content to my initial width, that was the property I remember there, multiplied by pinch.scale, and then initial height multiplied by pinch.scale, and here's the new one, pinch.center. So let's just go and look at, so no documentation going here, let me go and look at the pinch area. So pinch, we have that here. Pinch.center is, pinch.center is not in this list. The reason why it's not in that list is because some really dark magic happening behind the scene. The pinch element that you get here, or the pinch that I'm referring to in pinch.scale and pinch.center here, is not the pinch element or the pinch area itself. It's actually a parameter that comes with a signal handler. So had this been C++, you would not have been surprised that you had a function that took a parameter. But you have a bit of a problem here, because if I go and look at my pinch area here, I can look at my pinch update signals. It doesn't say down here that it actually brings out parameters. It does sometimes in the QML documentation, so it might actually be a bug that it doesn't show you here, but I'll show you how you can learn about that yourself. So the only way to tell is to actually go to the Qt source code. So I have a setting in my Qt creator that allows me to write Qt and then actually search the source code. In a separate video, I'll show you how to set that up. One thing you need to know when you're looking at the Qt source code for QML is that any element on the QML side has a C++ class on the C++ side. And these classes are always in files that start with Qt, and then the name of the element that we are looking at, so pinch area underscore p.h. This would be the one, right one. And you can see I already searched for it here. So pinch update, that's a signal that we see the signal handler on the QML side. Remember, signal handler is the name of the signal, and then the signal handler is called on, and then the name of the signal. So on pinch update on the C++ side is called pinch update. And we can see that it brings out this Qt quick pinch event. And now if I press F2 there, here is my Qt quick pinch event, and I can see all the properties that this one have. So that allows me to dive into the C++ site and understand what is available there. Okay, so whenever I'm pinching, I'm resizing the flick, and we can see that with this this little trick here on width changed, console.log width. And if I run my application again here and I flick it, you can see in my application output, it did not print anything. Of course it didn't, it wasn't the width of the, it's the content width that is changing, not the width. So we'll go again here on content width changed, console.log, content width. And now hopefully when I run it and I pinch it, I can get my fingers pinching it, there you can see on standard output that it prints the new size of my content width all the time. So that was flicking, that was pinching. As I said, swipe, we'll dedicate a video for that once we learned about list view. Now we have tap and hold. The way that tap and hold is that I simply press down my finger or my mouse button and hold it down for a second and then it will execute. And that's super simple to do in QML simply because we have the mouse area on which we have the on, press and hold signal handler where I can do stuff. So on, press and hold, change the is active, and the is active is a property that I created myself. And the is active is making the color of my text element here either green or black. We've seen a number of different gestures now, but you might have your own gestures. We have this wheel example, for example, gesture that you want to do where none of the built-in gestures in QML code for you. In that situation, you can create your own one. Let me just start up this example here in QCreator. So this example here, what I do is I got my fingers, I press down a finger, and you can see when I press my finger, it's moving it around, but I can do multiple finger touches here, and you can see that the rectangles, the color under a given finger stays the same. And the way that it works in code is I simply create an instance of this multi-point touch area element. I anchor that as usual. It has a few properties. One of them is how many fingers at least must it be. So I could tell it that it wouldn't activate before I got at least three fingers or four fingers or whatever, and the maximum amount of fingers. If I put in four fingers here now, you can see that it doesn't activate anymore once my fourth finger comes. I cannot get my four fingers to touch on the same millisecond, but you can see one finger work fine, two finger work fine, three fingers work fine, but when the fourth finger comes around, the multi-touch area doesn't activate anymore. And now, I guess this is the first time in this video series that we actually see a list of things. So my touch point is a list, and that's the square bracket that we have here, of three touch points that each have an ID. And then the rest of the code simply refers to those touch points. So the position of this rectangle that is 200 by 200, its X position is the touch point's X position. So that element has an X position minus the width of my rectangle so that my finger is in the center of the rectangle. Same thing for the Y. And the visible, my rectangle will only be visible if that finger is touched. That's it for this section on gestures. We still miss the swipe in the notes below. You can click, go straight to swipe if you need that right away. Otherwise, it will come up in videos once we talked about the list view element. In the next section, we're going to talk about keyboard input. So if your device do not have a keyboard, hey, feel free to skip that one and go straight to the next module.